Belinda Audio present this unabridged recording of The Legend of Gap-Toothed Jack, written and read by Guy Bass.
Greetings to TikTokers, Swiss cheeses, and hurlypots, to the imaginary and the unimaginary, to the living, the dead, and everyone in between. My name is Keys, Skeleton Keys. Ages or so ago, long before you were even thinking about being born, I was an if, an imaginary friend. Then, before I knew what was happening, I was suddenly as real as a dog's tail. I had become unimaginary. But that was a lifetime or three ago. Nowadays, I concern myself with those ifs who have been recently unimagined. Wherever they may appear, so does old Mr. Keys. For these fantabulent fingers of mine open doors to anywhere and elsewhere. Hidden worlds, secret places, doors to the limitless realm of all imagination. Oh, glorious burden! These keys have opened more doors than you have had biscuits! And each door has led to an adventure that would make a head spin from its neck. The stories I could tell you. But of course, you would not be here if you did not want a story. Well, never fear, Dally Wanglers. Today I have a hum-dum dinger of a tale to make even the soundest mind loop-de-loop. Brace your britches for the truly unbelievable, unbelievably true tale I have called The Legend of Gap-Toothed Jack. Ah, Gap-Toothed Jack, thief, adventurer, champion of imagining. Jack was a friend to some, hero to others, and a right pain in the rumplings for every folk else. The flabbergasting fable of Gap-Toothed Jack is even older than I. But to find our way to the past, we must begin in the present, with a second story and a boy named Casper. Casper has what we in the business of imagining call a wild imagination. On the seventh day of his seventh year, Casper imagined himself a friend. He did not need to, perhaps, for he had friends enough, but imaginations are not trussed and tethered by need. Imaginations run free. Casper named his if Wordy Gerdy. Gerdy was a ghost of a girl with a most remarkable ability. With pen in hand, she could rewrite the story of life itself. Let us suppose you have a pet dog. If Wordy Gerdy rewrote your story, you might suddenly have a cat instead. And what is more, you would not even know that anything had changed. You would be as sure as shampoo that you had always had a cat. Now, imagine if Wordy Gerdy became unimaginable. If her power to rewrite stories became real, what then is to stop chaos, confusion, or even calamity? Well, strange things can happen when imaginations run wild. Join me as I begin to unravel the mystery of the myth of the legend of Gap-Toothed Jack by first paying a much-needed visit to Casper and his family. Their house, dwarfed by the sprawling city that surrounds it, shuddles and shakes as a thunderstorm rages outside. The story has just begun, and yet it has already been rewritten.
Chapter 1. Rewritten. Meet the family.
With a turn of a key, the adventure begins. S.K.
Knock, knock, knock.
Casper was lying on the living room floor, watching his third favourite episode of Howie Hauser's Haunted Trousers, when the knock came. Mom, he called, not taking his eyes off the television. The sound of the thunderstorm outside swallowed his call. Dad, someone's at the door. There was no answer from the kitchen. Casper wasn't about to move, not with the episode reaching its haunting high point. He turned up the volume as thunder clapped outside. Then, click, clunk. A key turned in the lock. Casper sat up. Everyone was in the kitchen. Mum, Dad, Jacob, the twins. So who was unlocking the front door? A cold shiver ran down Casper's back. He got to his feet and turned to see the door creak slowly open. Rain lashed in as lightning forked in the night sky, illuminating a tall, lean figure standing in the doorway.
"Forgive my intrudings," the figure said. "I fear that if I do not come in, I might drown in this thundersome weather."
The figure took off a wide, three-peaked hat to reveal a grinning, bone-white skull. Casper gasped and stumbled backwards until he was pressed against the television.
"Fret not, I am not so spine-chillering as I look," the skeleton said as he stepped inside. "I'm afraid skinless is how I came into this world, so skinless is how I remain."
Casper tried to call out, but fear caught the cry in his throat.
"My name is Keys, Skeleton Keys," the skeleton continued,
placing his hat on the nearby sofa and shaking the raindrops from his coat.
"And you need not be afeard. After all, you brought me here."
I did, Casper blurted.
"Well, someone did," replied Skeleton Keys, glancing around. "For although I was far that away in the comfort of my dominion, I felt the twitch. That most soul-clattering rattle of the bones that alerts me to a new unimagining."
I don't understand, Casper replied.
"Somewhere in this house is an if, an imaginary friend that has been brought to life," the skeleton declared. "Have you not noticed anything oddish or outlandish of late? Unimaginary friends do tend to be accompanied by the most flabbergasting freakery."
"I don't know what you..."
"Wait." Casper scratched the back of his head, the fog of fear clearing a little.
"Like what happened to Wordy Gerdy?"
he asked.
"Who?"
My friend. I mean, not my real friend," Casper replied. "Except now she is."
"Now she is your real friend, or now she is real?" Skeleton Keys asked, leaning towards him.
"Really real," Casper explained.
"How real? As real as a vivid dream? As real as a stubbed toe? As real as rock cakes?"
"I was thinking about her, and all of a sudden she wasn't in my head anymore. She was right there in front of me. She was..."
"Unimaginary," Skeleton Keys interrupted. "I knew it! My twitch was right on the money! Now tell me, Casper, where is this Wordy Gerdy?"
Casper pointed to a door at the far end of the room.
"In the kitchen with everyone else."
"Then fret not! Old Mr. Keys is on the case," declared Skeleton Keys, taking long, deliberate strides towards the kitchen.
He pushed open the door and strode inside to find Casper's family sitting around a small, white table.
"Dogs and cats!" the skeleton gasped.
"Mum, Dad, this is Mr. Keys," said Casper, following in behind.
"How do you do, Mr. Keys?" said Casper's mum. "May I offer you a cup of tea?"
"Well, I'm afraid it would have nowhere to go," replied Skeleton Keys. "Thank you all the same."
"Then something to eat?" added Casper's mum.
"Carrots!"
cried Casper's dad.
"Oh, it's always carrots for you," sighed Casper's mum.
Skeleton Keys scratched his skull with a key-tipped finger before ushering Casper to a corner of the kitchen.
"Forgive me for asking," he whispered. "But are you sure this is your family?"
"What?"
"Yeah,"
replied Casper. "What do you mean?"
"It is just that I could not help but notice that your father is a very large rabbit."
Casper looked at his dad. Sure enough, he was a brown-grey rabbit the size of a bear. Casper shrugged. What else would he be? He said.
Carrots! Carrots!
Shouted the enormous rabbit, thumping his great foot against the floor.
I also note, Skeleton Keys continued, that your mother is, well, is...
Is what? Casper's mother interrupted. She stood on the kitchen table, her hands on her hips. She was no taller than a teacup. These are modern times, Mr. Keys. Families come in all shapes and sizes.
Quite so, but...
uttered the skeleton, gazing in bafflement at a pair of hamster-sized sky-blue elephants, huddled together in a high chair on the other side of the table. That's Sophie and Ingrid. They're twins, Casper explained as both elephants let out an identical trumpeting sound. Then he pointed to a sock puppet with buttons for eyes, draped lifelessly on the kitchen table. And that's my big brother, Jacob. Don't mind him. You'll be lucky to get two words out of him all year, Casper's tiny mother tutted as Skeleton Keys leaned in to inspect the sock puppet. You know what teenagers are like. Chapter 2. Wordy Gerdy, the Ghostwriter.
Imagination never fails, but no one else should write your tales. S.K.
Crumb crinkles,
said Skeleton Keys, gazing around the room at Casper's decidedly unconventional family.
Who did all this?
Did all what?
Casper asked.
Carrots!
Boomed Casper's dad.
Why, this, and this, and this, and... By my buckles, this!
Skeleton Keys cried, pointing at each of Casper's family members in turn.
Who transformed, transmogrified, and transfigured these poor dally-wanglers? You are not trying to tell me that your father has always been a rabbit.
Always,
replied Casper, as if the word had suddenly illuminated a hidden memory.
I mean, I don't remember him being anything else. But I guess I don't remember him being a rabbit either.
I do believe you were as confuddled as your family is converted, and that this is the work of an unimaginary, declared Skeleton Keys, craning low to eyeball Casper. Where is your if, Casper? Where is...
Didn't do it!
The cry came from inside a low cupboard at the far end of the kitchen. Skeleton Keys tilted his head with a dry creak, his milk-white eyeballs fixing upon a rattling cupboard door. He reached the cupboard in two long strides. It rattled again as he wrapped his key-tipped fingers around the door handle.
Wordy Gerdy, is that...
Didn't do it!
The cupboard doors were suddenly flung open from the inside, sending Skeleton Keys flying. A strange, ghostly girl burst from within and hovered impossibly in the air. She flitted around the room in panic before finally settling in the far corner of the kitchen, like a bee exhausted from buzzing around a window. Though she was solid enough, the girl was faintly see-through and emitted a greenish-white glow.
Wordy Gerdy, I presume, said Skeleton Keys, dusting himself off.
Gerdy didn't do it! Gerdy didn't change a thing! Everything like this already!
The ghoulish girl hovered in the air again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.